Hi, I'm Dr. Mona Gahunia. I'm an infectious disease physician with the Mid-Atlantic Permanente Medical Group. And I'm here today for the first time on Instagram Live. I don't even have Instagram on my phone, but I'm doing this because I think it's a really important time in the pandemic to get some messaging out there to the larger community, and certainly to anyone who is a KP Mid-Atlantic member. Because I think people are feeling like they have more questions than answers right now with the quickly changing CDC guidelines and other guidelines that may be coming from their local health departments. And what you're feeling now, the possible frustration, the fatigue, the urgency to return to normal, but then being pulled back, certainly is what I think we're all experiencing and certainly is validated. And so I wanted to first recognize those feelings and then be able to provide just a little bit of advice and reassurance about where we are in the pandemic and where we may be headed. So the good news, first of all, is that we heard some really reassuring news this week, is that about 70% of Americans have received at least one dose of the vaccine, which puts us in a much better place than just about every other country in the world. And so that is going to be our number one tool against the Delta variant and any other variants that come down the line. And so let's not forget that. Let's not forget how the vaccine is the most powerful tool and something that we have. And please get your family, your friends, your neighbors who have not yet been vaccinated out there to get the vaccine. It's truly a race between the vaccines and the variants, and we have to win this race. And if people are still hesitant about the vaccine, ask them why. Ask them, you know, what's holding them back, and then really try to provide them with an empathetic ear, but also facts and information that might help change their minds, and refer them to others who may know more about the vaccines. And so that's one thing I wanted to start with, but I also wanted to talk a little bit about what public health professionals and agencies like the CDC and others are trying to communicate right now and are learning. So this is a fast-moving pandemic. There were parts of it that were a little bit slower. We had time to catch up. We had time to process the science, the data, the knowledge that we had gained about COVID and put it into practice, but we're in a phase of the pandemic where we're seeing the Delta variant predominate here in the US, but we're learning rapidly because the Delta variant has affected many countries. Those countries were not as well vaccinated. So it's going to look different here than it did in other places. And that's the part that is gonna take us a little bit of time to learn about. In the meantime, the CDC came out with new guidelines last week, partly out of an abundance of caution. And really the shift in those guidelines was regarding advice for vaccinated people. And what they said was that in areas of substantial or high transmission, and what that means is areas of the community where the viral spread is increasing rapidly and is high, even vaccinated people should consider wearing a mask in an indoor public setting. And what we mean by that is a public setting is a place where you're with people who you don't know. They're not your family members. You don't know what their vaccination status is. You don't know where they've been. You don't know if they're sick. So in those situations, it is important to wear a mask. And if you're not sure about the transmission rate in your community, it's safer just to wear a mask than not to wear a mask. And those transmission rates are constantly shifting and changing. So it is really hard to keep up. So a good rule of thumb is that if you're going to be in an indoor crowded situation, especially, it's safer to wear a mask at this point than not to. I want to reassure those who've taken the time and effort to get vaccinated that the majority of infections continue to be among the unvaccinated. And those who are vaccinated and are getting infected to date have had much milder cases and sometimes not even any symptoms, and they're picked up because they're traveling or because of a known exposure. And so that's one really reassuring fact. And the vast majority of people who have symptoms who are vaccinated have simple cold-like symptoms versus a much more severe cases that we're seeing in the unvaccinated population. And that's why there's this urgency, because the Delta variant will cause more severe cases in the unvaccinated population. We're starting to see that. That was the experience in other countries. And we should take those lessons from the rest of the world and apply them here and talk right now to our friends, our neighbors, our family members who've been holding out for, you know, whatever reason. I think the other thing that people are worried about right now is their kids, because as we all know, there's no vaccine approved for kids under 12. And we were all holding out hope that it would be coming soon, especially aligned with the opening of schools. And that's likely not going to happen. And it's for good reason. It's because our FDA has such a rigorous process in evaluating the safety of these vaccines. And they want to ensure safety, especially for children under 12. And so they're taking a little bit more time. They're asking the companies, Pfizer, Moderna, J&J, for more data and more evidence to prove that the vaccines are truly safe for all, including kids under 12. And I think the outcome is going to be positive. I think it's just going to be a slight delay. In the meantime, families are forced to make decisions about whether their kids should go back to school, especially in public schools where it's harder to social distance. And so I think we're all going to be learning what schools and the Delta variant together mean. The good news is that over the last school year, we didn't see very high levels of transmission, even in public schools, if the right measures were put in place. And the CDC has really great guidelines for schools. And we're at a point where we've learned so much about how to contain the virus with simple measures like masking, like some level of distancing and proper hand hygiene. The other really reassuring piece is that staff and teachers have had the opportunity to get the vaccine. So there's a much less likelihood that they'll be bringing the virus into the schools, where that was a completely different situation in the early part of the pandemic. So those are key factors. Also, the other piece that has changed is that we have wide availability of COVID testing, which we didn't always have in every stage of the pandemic. So if there are to be situations where kids are sick or there is a small outbreak in a school, it can quickly be contained through aggressive testing strategies and pulling those sick children out quickly. And the other reassuring thing to date has been that most kids don't get overwhelmingly, you know, sick with COVID. We're going to continue to watch that and see if that changes with the Delta variant. It's too early to say for sure. But overall, kids are at lower risk for severe disease. So I know parents like myself. I have an 8 and a 10-year-old who I planned to send back to school, and I'm still planning to send back to school. They've been virtual for the entire pandemic because that was the right decision for our family. But my older son's going into fifth grade, and he needs to be back in that environment with other kids, his teachers. And so I'm weighing the risks and benefits of that and coming to the decision that's best for our family. And so that's what every family has to do. They have to weigh the level of risk they're willing to accept, think about their entire family situation, who else might be in the household. One of the key factors is, are you living with someone who's immunocompromised, or are you living with someone who has not been vaccinated? So those might play into your decisions. And also checking with your school and finding out what policies they're gonna have in place is really, really important to help you make the most informed and best decision. And staying up to date with the latest guidelines. The situation is changing rapidly. And your public health authorities, the CDC, your local health departments, and organizations like Kaiser Permanente, like the Mid-Atlantic Permanente Medical Group, we're going to do our best to keep you up to date as the situation evolves and we learn more. it's been a humbling time for everybody in healthcare because we're used to knowing about diseases and knowing the best strategies and treatments. And with COVID, we're learning as we go. And we're building on our knowledge and doing the best with what we know at the time and really trying to push out information in a timely manner. Yeah, those were the major messages that I wanted to talk about today. And I would say if you have questions, if you have concerns, try to go to reliable sources. Don't go to unreliable sources. So look at your local health department, look at the CDC, check kp.org, check with your doctor about what your questions are, and get reliable information, because misinformation can be really problematic, especially when things are changing so quickly. So thank you, and I hope that this helped reassure you to some degree.